One thing, we do have to make an announcement that because of the number of people that are here and the small size, that if there is a fire, just follow me. I just want to thank you guys. This is these people are what made it happen, and I also want to thank all the volunteers and all the missionaries that got dressed up tonight to be able to make this happen, because to change this room over takes a Herculean effort, and not only that, but to change it back takes an even bigger effort. So I want to thank you guys. If you guys have any questions, anybody that's in camo, they can answer them for you. They may or may not be wearing their hats because I forced them to wear them. All right, are you guys ready to get started?
Yeah!
All right. So, but seriously, the reason why I call it the combating the blood sugar battle, because some people are like, wow, I just don't really like kind of the war theme, right? I don't like the combat theme. Like, it's kind of not like you, Dr. Osborne, to have like this battle type thing, because I'm not into battles, I'm not into fights, but you have to understand we are at a war, and you, by the time we are finished with this talk tonight, 360 people in the United States will have died of diabetes. Every 10 seconds in the United States right now, somebody dies of diabetes. And if you are born in 2010, you have a 30% chance of dying from diabetes, period. Those are the stats. And so this is a war, and we're not just fighting against something, we're fighting for people. We're fighting for ourselves. And so I'm going to take you on a trip tonight, and it's going to be up to you whether you want to go there. And you can open your mind, or you can close your mind. That's all right. It might fall down.
Fell down.
There we go. Watch this. Well, I don't know what's going on. All my parachuters and stuff fell down.
Yep.
That's all right. It'll come down tonight.
There isn't
we're going to take you on a trip tonight. Has anybody ever seen The Matrix?
Yeah.
Okay, one of my favorite movies of all time, Matrix 1, Matrix 2, Matrix 3, and they're doing a remake of it. But my son says the second and third one were lame, and the fourth will probably be lame anyway. But the point of it is there's a guy in there, and he asks Neo whether he wants to go and learn. And so he asked me, he says, you take the blue pill, and the story ends tonight. And you wake up in your bed, and you just believe whatever you want to believe. But if you take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. This is Wonderland, by the way. And I show you how deep this blood sugar rabbit goes. And that's where you're going to have to make a choice. You're going to take the blue pill, or you're going to take the red pill. And if you take the blue pill, well, you'll just be a statistic. If you take the red pill, well, then you actually have a choice. Because then you can be a warrior, and you can fight for yourself, and you can fight for your families out there. Because whether you want to believe it or not, whether you want to do anything about it or not, it will affect you, and it will affect everyone around you. Statistically, right now, that we have 43% of people in the United States are either diabetic or pre-diabetic. What does that mean, right? Like you hear about it, it's just like a blood sugar issue. So, are we a red pill or blue people? Okay, we're gonna take the red pill here. So, it might be a little harsh, but I need you to understand what diabetes is, okay? So this is diabetes right here, okay? I want you to understand this is diabetes. It's not a blood sugar issue. This right here is diabetes. You have a 200 to 400 times greater risk of having a heart attack and dying from that heart attack or stroke if you have diabetes. It's not just about eating an eclair. It's a blood sugar. It's not just about blood sugar. It's about living. This is diabetes. If you have diabetes, you're going to 75% of people that have high blood pressure have diabetes. So if you're trying to fight blood sugar, your high blood pressure, without addressing the diabetes that's causing the high blood pressure, the same thing that causes diabetes is the same thing that causes high blood pressure there. Blindness. The number one cause of blindness if you're between 20 and 70 years old is diabetes. That is diabetes. This is serious stuff. It's not just about losing weight. I need you to understand this, because when you start looking at, right now we have 48,000 people a year that start dialysis. They start dialysis for chronic kidney dysfunction. We have 248,000 people that go into kidney failure a year due to diabetes. Kidney failure, that means that your kidneys shut down and you can't detoxify your body, and literally it's the beginning of the end if you don't do something about it. What I'm here to tell you is that it is reversible there. This is diabetes right here. This is a healthy brain. This is an autistic, I mean not an autistic brain, this is a
diabetic.
A diabetic brain, somebody that has Alzheimer's disease. See, what they now call Alzheimer's is actually type 3 diabetes. Because what they didn't know until just a few years ago is that your brain actually produces insulin. Your brain needs so much, it actually produces its own insulin. So you can get sugar into your brain. The problem is that if you're not able to get sugar into your brain, it's living tissue and it dies there. So if your body's insulin resistant, so is your brain, it is insulin resistant. We start to find that we lose our ability to focus, we lose cognitive function, we lose our memory, we start to get cloudy thinking when we have diabetes or our blood sugar there. This is diabetes, is Alzheimer's there. Diabetes is the number one cause of amputations in the United States. It's not just about the blood sugar. Diabetes is 30% of people that have diabetes have severe periodontal disease, meaning that they have severe dental issues there. So of all the, let me rephrase that, 30% of all severe dental issues in the United States right now are related to diabetes. So if you like your teeth, it's not just about brushing them to get the sugar off of them. And, I like that. Hey, by the way, that reminds me. If you have a phone, this would be the only time that you get to use the phone here. Is that you actually get to share you get to share it on there. So people are, we're actually streaming it live just because we couldn't fit any other people in there. You have right now that we almost 30% of spontaneous abortions or miscarriages are directly related to blood sugar issues there. Think about that. Like, think about the pain that somebody goes through. 30% and 1 in 10 birth defects is a blood sugar issue there. And the problem is this, it's not just about the people that are alive. Look at these numbers. It's not just about the people that are in this room, the people in our family, the people that we know. 38%, almost 40% of the people, the mortalities are directly attributable to the deaths in the United States are directly attributable to diabetes. And the problem is you don't see diabetes on the death certificate. It's like, it doesn't say, I died of diabetes. Does that make sense? And when it does say that, it's the seventh leading cause of death in the United States. But what happens is that 40% of all deaths are directly attributable to the side effects of diabetes. If you go into different countries, it gets up to 76% of it. This is an epidemic, a global epidemic like nothing we have ever seen before in this entire planet. And what I want you to know is that if you go back to 1920, the number of people with diabetes was, check this out, 0.00019% of the population. That's the 10th, that's the 100th, that's the 1,000th, that's the 10,000th place. That was meaning that you're about 1 in 10,000 people had diabetes right now. Right now it's 1 in 2. Something has changed. It's not your genes. It's not bad luck. It's not just, it just doesn't happen to you. And what changed, we'll go into this a little bit, but we don't have time tonight because I promised my wife I'd end on time. But what changed is this, the way that we eat and the way that we lived our life and our lifestyles there. And so what I also want to think, let you know, is what we think is normal isn't normal. Like our perception of what normal is completely changed. So you look at Marilyn Monroe in 1958, she was a size 12. If she was today, she would be a size six, because in 1983, the uniform sizing code actually changed. They got rid of it. It doesn't exist anymore. So you can, depending, have you ever noticed this? You go to one store, you're like a size six, you go to another store, you're size 10, and you're like, I'm gonna shop the size six store, right? But in 1983, they actually changed it, so they got rid of the uniform sizing code. So you can make whatever size be whatever you wanna be. So as people got bigger, they just changed it like a size 12 to a size 10, and it made you feel good. So you got comfortable in your dysfunction as we slowly started to break down there. And what we started to see is, this all started back in the early 60s, but you can start to see as our waist went up in inches. This is a size 20 right here in 2011, and you can see that back down here, this was a size 12. Like the size 20 at one time, there was a size 20 at one time, is now a size 12. Is that amazing? Mm-hmm. That's crazy. There was a Bridget Bardot is, well, this will pop up every once in a while, so they'll be famous. But the point is, Bridget Bardot, you know, if you remember her from the 60s, she was like, you know, very thin. She would actually be a size 10. I mean, she was a size 8 at that time now. She'd be a 0 now. That's amazing. So how does this happen? So we have diabetes. What the heck? We know that it has something to do with size. We know that something has changed. So I chose this. This is the year I graduated from chiropractic college, 1994. So in 1994, we look at this in the United States. We look at our obesity charts. And it says... 0, well, everybody in the United States had, every state had some level of obesity, but all of these light blue states, it was less than 10% of the people were obese in those light blue states. And then we had a medium blue, and then we had like a dark blue. So we're gonna go fast forward 20 years in practice. 2015, latest numbers. Do you see any blue? No, they had to get rid of all the blues, and they actually made five new colors there. They actually now, these red states, and this was, 2 years ago? These red states are 35%. And so we're starting to see, as the numbers are going up, as the obesity levels are going up, as our weight's going up, our diabetes levels are going up, but our DNA isn't changing. So there has to be something that we're doing. And in fact, what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to coin something for you, because I want you to get this in your head from this perspective. We're going to call it diabesity. The diabesity, because it's going to be an interconnection between those two things. And but those two conditions have the same causes. They have the same causes. So this is why, this is what I was saying, is that as these numbers, like this is 1990, red is diabetes, yellow is our mean body weight, and you can just see them climb in proportion to each other. So, I mean, basically, we can't, if diabetes is important to you, then we have to make some changes there. And the place that we make some changes is not managing it. We can't manage it. I want you to think of diabetes as an injury. Like, if I had if you came in and your back was really bad, I said, hey, we'll just kind of keep it just the way it is. We just don't want it to get worse, too much worse. But it'll get worse over time, but we'll just kind of keep it from getting as worse. You'd be like, oh, this is the wrong place for me, right? But like when somebody goes to their diabetes doctor, he's like, yeah, it's a condition that we just have to learn to manage. We'll manage your diabetes. No, like if I had a sprained ankle, you don't manage my sprained ankle, you fix my sprained ankle. Does that make sense? You treat it, so you resolve the problem there. And that's the challenge. We're not resolving the problem, we're just treating the symptom of it. And treating the symptom, as you're going to see in a second, is incredibly disastrous. And it creates a vicious downward spiral that literally affects every single tissue, cell, and organ in your entire body there. So how do we get here? What I got to tell you is this. Obviously, it's a sugar issue, right? And the thing about sugar is, look, I was just on vacation, and it was an all-you-can-eat place. And it was all-you-can-eat French food. And so you literally walk in there, and it's like, Like every like cell in my body was just craving. And so, you know, we were just talking about this a second ago. You get to you eat your meal, and then you go to walk out, and they have this table that's from here past there just filled with desserts. Like everything that you ever wanted in your entire life is right there. And it's almost like, what do? Because our brains are wired to want to eat it. And that's because we like it, we crave it. And it has addictive properties. Most foods right now are created to have what we call a bliss point, a point at which it triggers your brain to say, oh my gosh, that is fantastic. Just the right amount of salt, just the right amount of sweet, just the right amount of this, just the right amount of that to get into your brain to create an addiction. And so what happens is we eat the sugar, and then all of a sudden our blood levels spike and we're like, oh my gosh, something has to happen. Because the problem is when our blood levels spike, you can only have a teaspoon of sugar in your body, and then anything in your bloodstream, and anything more than that's lethal. So what your body does is it raises up your something called insulin, and when it raises up the insulin, what it's trying to do is to get that sugar into a place that it can be, to get it out of the bloodstream. The problem is that while that blood sugar is there, you get something called dopamine. And dopamine is what cocaine addicts, why they do cocaine for the dopamine. It gives you, it's that happy hormone, it's that, you get that satisfied feeling. So when we're not satisfied enough, have you ever noticed that when you're like stressed or depressed or something like that, and you're not feeling satisfied with your life, guess what's the first thing that we start to do? We start spending time in the fridge, right? And then we start spending time, oh, I just want my nighttime snack before I go to bed. What it does is it's not the food. You don't crave the food, you crave the dopamine. You crave the high of the food that the food actually gives you. But the problem is you get this mass insulin secreted, and it drops your blood sugar down. And now all of a sudden, have you ever noticed, we call it Chinese food syndrome, right? So you go out to Chinese food, and then there's all the rice, right? And then you, and it's so addictive because of the flavor. And so you eat until you can't what? Eat anymore and move, right? And you're like, oh my gosh, there's that one like mushy wonton thing, whatever, right?
I can eat it, just push that over and I can get it right down.
So we get it right down, and then what happens an hour later?
You're hungry.
You're hungry, right? Because what your body did is it had to dump that insulin in there to drop that blood sugar because it was such an emergency. And so then all of a sudden our blood sugar levels drop, and all of a sudden the problem is that you can only have so much sugar getting into your cells. So insulin is what we call our fat hormone. It's the hormone that makes us fat. If you want to become fat, just have high insulin levels in your body, because what your body does is it takes all that extra sugar and it turns it into fat. That's what it does. It has to go somewhere, unless you're going to throw it up, which I'm not going to suggest that you do at a restaurant. The second thing is now your blood sugar is low, so guess what happens? And our dopamine levels go down, our satisfaction goes down, so we start to crave it, we start getting the craving, and we start repeating the cycle. And that, have you ever noticed that we call it grazing? Those are the days where, like, you go and there's only crackers in the cabinet, you start eating crackers there, and then there's some old pasta there. And the next thing you know, like, you're going through the freezer trying to find stuff, and you're like literally cooking things. It's like a 12-hour thing. You're like, okay, let's go out to eat, but you're not really hungry because your stomach's full, but your brain's telling you that you're hungry there. And it goes until you go to bed at night, and you wake up and you can't figure out why you have no energy the next morning. So this is what I want you to understand. It's sugar is an addictive thing. This is a normal brain on what they call a spec scan. This is a person that has addicted to cocaine. This is a person's brain that is that is obese, that is addicted to carbohydrates and being overweight there, okay? And there's no difference between a cocaine user's brain. It's the same addictive properties. It's the dopamine that's constantly being circulated there. So it's not that somebody's a bad person. It's not that they don't have willpower. It's not that somebody is like has no control. It's what happens is you have to understand that the food is very addictive to us. And with what I was talking about earlier, what happened in the 20s? Well, and they started to come out with the different types of fats. They started to pull out the good, you didn't like go out and get vegetables anymore. They started to have mass produced food in the 20s. And then all of a sudden in the 70s, they started coming out with like packaged foods and trans fats, and they started changing. And then all of a sudden we had this low fat, low sugar revolution, right? So now we got rid of all the fat. We gave everybody as much sugar and as much dietary food and healthy food as they possibly could. And next thing you know, we have this diabetes epidemic. So the number one rule that we start off with is everything that they've told you up to this point, don't do, okay? Because obviously it's not working. Like, you have to rethink, and that's what tonight's about. It's about rethinking. So we were all born addicts, by the way. Like, that's how we were born, to survive. Our brains are wired for this satisfaction. And basically, when we do that, it's the same thing as the same thing is triggered that triggers morphine or heroin when we eat carbohydrates and sugars there. It's more addictive than intravenous cocaine. They gave rats choices whether they'd rather have sugar or intravenous cocaine. They chose sugar over intravenous cocaine. The sweet receptors are on your tongue. They're incredibly sensitive on your tongue. In fact, your tongue is so sensitive that they did a study in which they took the concentration of Sydney Harbor and they poured a thimble full of sugar into water, and the taste bud was able to detect the increase of sweetness at that dilution there. That's how sensitive those taste buds are. And what it's designed to do is a survival instinct. It overrides all of our self-control. And it leads to addiction. It's impossible to overwhelm, and we have to eliminate sugar. That's the number one thing. We really have to eliminate all sugar from our diet. If we don't, the thing is, I like it. I like sugar. Of course you do. You're biologically designed to like sugar. Does that make sense? Like you can tell yourself anything that you want, just because like you're biologically designed to like cocaine. But the thing is that if I was to say, hey, you know, go ahead, do cocaine, do more, you know, heroin, do whatever, morphine, whatever you want, it's fine. You know that there's going to be problems, and it's the other white death. And I want you to think about that. It's just the white death, because that's what it leads to there. So we think of sugar as type 2 diabetes as sugar, and it uses insulin, and what its job is to move the sugar into our cells for energy there, and to get it out of the bloodstream there. Problem is that the average person's eating 150 pounds of sugar a year. 150 pounds of sugar. Like, that's a big pile of sugar. Like, we're only supposed to have about 40 to 60 grams of sugar a day. But we're having 150 pounds a year. And in fact, the American Diabetic Association recommends that you have between 40 and 65 grams of sugar per meal, like of carbohydrates per meal. How's that working out? It's not working out really well, right? I mean, they have a huge population of people that are keeping on having worse and worse diabetes every year. If you with those recommendations, and I'm going to show you in a second, there will be a slide that actually compares, like with blood sugar levels, the people that follow the ADA recommendations and people that follow the common sense recommendations there. So what ends up happening is that normally with type 2 diabetes, it goes into this, like type 1, we're not going to really be talking too much about it tonight, but type 1 can become a type 2 diabetes. And tonight, I just want to talk to you about insulin-resistant diabetes. Because insulin-resistant diabetes affects 95%, or is 95% of all diabetics out there. But what happens is the amount of sugar comes in, and it's like, after a while, you have enough of something, and like, it's like has anybody ever gone into a football locker room? I take care of like some of the professional sports teams in the area, and like when I walk into the locker room and they come off the ice, it's like they smell, right? But they don't smell themselves. Like they just don't smell their pads. They don't smell their feet. They're just used to it. And that's what ends up happening to the insulin receptors. They just get used to it. They stop paying attention to the insulin there. And so then the basically what ends up happening is that the insulin has to go up more and more and more and more to get it to pay attention. And finally it stops paying attention. It's like having a two-year-old like running around the house yelling and screaming. If you were a single person, you put a two-year-old in your house, you'd hear every sound. But ask any parent after a few months, like you don't hear anything. You're like, unless they're like crying. So the way that we register this is that we look at something called A1C, right? And we look at how somebody's doing, like where they are in the diabetic process, looking at their A1C. And I'm going to tell you something. It's a very problematic thing, because when we look at an A1C, diabetics are very often not healthy. They're not healthy. So the A1C is looking at the amount of sugar on their red blood cells. And so a typical red blood cell will have a 90-day lifespan. Well, the average diabetic's red blood cells don't last that long. So they're going to have a false lower A1C. The more chronic somebody has diabetes, let's say they have a lower A1C, well, it's probably a false positive. It's probably much higher than it really is, because their blood cells aren't lasting as long. And that's critical. So we're going to have to start looking at different things there. But a lot of times people with normal, so what we really want to look at, though, is that there's a couple numbers. Basically, anything below 5.7 is good. Anything above 6.5, you got diabetes. Not even a question there. But we don't want to use that as the only indicator of how we're doing. So we look at, a lot of times we'll do a fasting glucose test. And the fasting glucose means that, like, we don't give you anything to eat. And then we take your blood sugar and we want to see how you're doing. You know, I have patients that are in the 400s when they first come in. Like, that's ridiculous. Like, that's like 911. That's where your brain stops working in the 400s at that point there. Pre-diabetic is 100 to 125. Diabetes is plus 125. But here's the problem. And this is what next time you go to get your annual physical, don't have them just check your blood sugar. Have them check your insulin level. And this is an important distinction here that I want you to remember. Because what ends up happening is a lot of times people will have a low blood sugar, but an incredibly high insulin level, because the body's working overtime, because it's such an incredibly important thing to keep that blood sugar down. So you could have a low blood sugar and think, oh my gosh, look, I look at the lifestyle I'm leading. I'm eating this, I'm eating that. Like, my blood sugar's fine. I don't have to make any changes there. But if you looked at your insulin level, it could be double or triple what is normal there. And that's the critical factor there. The other thing is that you want to look at your leptin levels. Because what leptin is that as your body's burnt, like as you have high insulin levels, what it'll do is that it means that your body's trying to take everything and turn it into fat. Okay, that's what insulin's job is, to take extra energy and turn it right into fat there. Now, interesting thing is that there's two types of fats that your body can actually use. It can use triglycerides. Does anybody know that anybody that has diabetes that has high triglycerides? That's what it is. It's not that you're eating bad food, Does that make sense? It's not that you're eating too much fat. It means that your body's doing what it's doing, and one of the side effects is that it's actually triglycerides. It's just part of the package there. So what ends up happening, though, is that once you get enough fat, there's a hormone called leptin. And what leptin does is it says, oh my gosh, I got enough energy stored right now that I need to turn off the hunger signal. And when I turn off the hunger signal, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start burning the fat. So you have one hormone that increases fat and the other one that says stop eating and actually start burning fat. Now the problem is if you keep on making fat and leptin is trying to say start burning fat, eventually both of them are going to be resistant. They're not going to pay attention. And that's when we get in that place where we get unregulated blood sugar and we get unregulated weight gain and we can't figure out what's going on. So diabetes is not a blood sugar issue, it's a hormonal issue. And that's what I need you to understand. It's not about the hormone, it's not about the sugar, it's about the hormones that it affects there. So one of the things that was interesting is that when you look at your leptin levels and your insulin levels, they're actually the greatest predictors of longevity. When they look at they go to countries what they call blue zones, and they look at the people that are centurions. Blue zones are countries that have the highest concentration of people that live to over 100 years old. And they look at their leptin levels and they look at their insulin levels. It's amazing. Leptin's incredibly low because these people don't have high, like weight, and their insulin levels leptin's high and their insulin levels are incredibly low there. So that's a big thing. So next time you get a test, if you really want to see where you're at, and if you really want to choose the red pill or the blue pill, ask for those tests, and that'll give you a much better indicator there. Problem is this. Once we get diabetes, what's the solution? Well, there's other things like metformin and all these different things that have crazy side effects there, but let's just talk about insulin, for example. Problem is that the solution would be, if you're not getting enough sugar into the cells, let's give you more insulin to get the sugar into the cells, right? That's crazy. That's absolutely crazy, because one of the problems is that over time, insulin's a mitogenic hormone, which means that it actually causes cells to grow. And when it causes cells to grow, one of the things that it does is it actually causes cancer. So now we're trying to fight a blood sugar issue where our cells stop listening to insulin, and then we give more insulin that causes increased cancer cell growth there. And oh, by the way, guess what cancer eats? Sugar. Right? So do you see this vicious cycle there? And so we can try to treat this, and we can try to treat this, and we can get to the cause there. But really one of the things is they basically found that when they look at people showing that intensive glucose lowering treatments, basically they had a 43% increased death rate. So maybe that's not a great approach to looking at healthcare. Or maybe we can look at something like Avandia. This one took about 10 years to get off the market. It's basically you increase your risk of having a cardiovascular death by 64%. I mean, that's like if you're flipping a coin, that's something that you would bet on if you were in Vegas, right? If you wanted to go to Vegas and win money, you would take a 64% bet, because that means you're probably going to win more likely than lose. So that means you're taking this for your diabetes means that you're probably going to have a cardiovascular death more likely than not have it, or have a heart attack there. 80,000 people suffered strokes directly as a result of this particular medication there. It took 10 years to get it off. Just so you know, you guys are guinea pigs. They have no idea, like they don't test it over a long term. It took 10 years for them to say, oh yeah, after 80,000 people die from it, probably a good idea to make some changes. And this isn't the only one. We have to stop treating the symptom. We can lower the blood sugar, and your lab test could look fantastic, but you're still toxic, right? You're still doing damage to your body, and that's what I want to get through to you. So really, who's responsible? It's you. You're responsible there. I mean, this is a disease that is nearly 100% curable. It's an injury. You treat an injury. You don't manage an injury. That's the shift that we have to have in our mindset. It's only curable when you get to the cause. The cause is the cure. We have to address the cause, and then we can get to the cure. And it's just as simple as that. So here's what I want to teach you tonight. This is my version of diabetes. And what I want to show you right here, this is insulin resistance down here. Okay, this is the last thing that shows up right down here. You can't really see it. It needs to be focused better. But what I want you to see is that the new diabesity maze, basically, the new research that comes out, they say obviously it's about lifestyle, but they also find that, do you see how all these things are interconnected? We might have a genetic predisposition to something. Of course, we all have genetic predispositions to things, but that's just a little bit. But when we start coming down, we look at the foods that we're eating and the lifestyle that we live. So we start looking at the dietary toxins like the wheats, which are inflammatory. We look at the sugars, which are inflammatory. We look at the canola oils and the industrial, the cottonseed oils and the corn oils and all these industrial seed products. Those are all inflammatory. The environmental toxins that we're exposed to, like the plastic water bottles, like that's why I want people to, like, can you imagine trying to fix diabetes without detoxing yourself? When all these things are inside, create the pesticides and the flame retardants that are on your mattresses. Those are all things that are bioaccumulating over time. And then we have these deficiencies. That if it's a deficiency, then it's a toxicity. Like if you don't have enough of something, it's going to create a problem. And so when we start looking at one of the biggest deficiencies is vitamin D. When people are vitamin D deficient, it creates an inflammatory process on the cell membrane. When you have that inflammatory process and all of these things create inflammation on the cell membrane, what it does is think about like a balloon, and it blows up over the receptor. It literally covers the receptor. So now, even if you had normal insulin, you couldn't even get that insulin into the receptor there. That's the key to understanding this, because inflammation also, what creates inflammation in this nutritional cycle will also create, the same thing that creates this will create obesity. Problem with obesity is that when the fat cells release something called cytokines, which are inflammatory products, which then go and create more inflammation in your body. And then all of a sudden, now we have obesity, we have leptin resistance, which then creates, you know, impaired glucose metabolism. And do you see it's a vicious downward spiral? So we can start right here and try to manage diabetes, or we can start up here at the top of the maze, address these issues, and if we do that, do you think we're going to have a much better chance of not having diabetes and having a longer, healthier life? So think about like that last time that you went to your doctor, if you have diabetes or have high blood sugar, did he actually mention like antibiotic use in your gut? No, that would, really? Because there's over 600 studies that directly point to diabetes linked to abnormal gut bacteria. Sedentary lifestyle, did he talk about vitamin D deficiency? So that's the thing, is if it's not working, then you better find somebody that's going to answer, give you better questions and give you better advice there. So here's the thing. Number two thing I want you to take home from today, you don't have to have sugar in your body. Does that make sense? So there's something that we call essential. You have essential nutrients. These are essential means that your body cannot produce it. So you have essential amino acids. So your body cannot produce these amino acids that it uses to rebuild itself. You have essential fatty acids like omega-3s that your body cannot produce to actually rebuild itself. Like you don't make omega-3s in your body. That's why they're essential. Your body can make sugar. It goes through a process in the liver called gluconeogenesis where it takes fat, puts it through the liver, and next thing you know you have sugar and everybody's happy there. That's it. Sugar is not an essential component. Like, you will not die if you don't have sugar. I promise you that. That's what the research shows. So it's protein which rebuilds you and fats which gives you energy there. So let's see how this works. So if we take what we've talked about today and we say, hey, let's run an experiment, right? Let's go to a country that up until, you know, 60 years ago, they pretty much did pretty good. They like 80-90% of all the food, I mean, they had no diabetes. Then all of a sudden, 60 years ago, you radically shifted. Like literally almost no diabetes 60 years ago there. And then you radically shifted, you bring 90% of your food, you have it imported there, and then all of a sudden, their diabetes rates become the highest diabetes rate in the entire planet. So when 90% of your food is processed food there, and imported food and packaged food that can be shipped overseas, of course you're going to have diabetes. That was your living experiment there. And so then this mission group came over, and what they did is they did this. The first 2 weeks was their intensive phase. They literally had to do a sugar detox on these people. They literally had to remove all sugars, grains, pastas, carbohydrates, crackers, anything that was in a package they didn't have, they got to, they basically had to get rid of there. Fasting blood glucose levels decreased an average of 50 to 100 points during those first 2 weeks. Is there any medication that anybody knows that can do that over a prolonged period of time without side effects? So you, the power's in you, and the thing you have to remember is the power's been stolen from you. They think that there's more power in a potion or a pill or a lotion or a shot than in the power that created the universe that put these plants and these foods here for you to eat in the first place. And so the, everything that man touches, we have a tendency to screw up, right? But it's, everything was perfect for us. So we have to get back to foods by God, not foods by man. So watch this. Their triglycerides fell 40 points in 2 weeks. That's without any doctor, by the way. That's without any pharmaceutical companies. That's without any that lowering your blood, your fat concentration there. Weight loss, they lost about 1 to 3 pounds per week. They got rid of all their joint pains. Oh, by the way, guess what that was caused by? Inflammation. It was caused by inflammation there. They had less frequent trips to the bathroom. Guess why they're going to the bathroom all the time? Because one of the side effects of diabetes is you're trying to get the sugar out of it as it's destroying your kidneys. It actually, you actually urinate that sugar out. And in fact, here's an interesting tip. That's how, before they had blood tests, that's how doctors used to test to see if somebody had diabetes. They would actually taste their urine. So, just so you know, we're not going to have a urine tasting. It's up to you. Like that's old school. I like to get back to basics, but I'm not going old school. More energy, increased mental capacity. So, does anybody want any of that?
Yeah.
Yeah. What if it was just increased mental capacity? Yeah. Right? Like, would you take it? Like more energy? Like, you have to understand is that, like, the as sugar comes into your cells, it destroys your mitochondria, which are your powerhouses. Literally, it like caramelizes. Like, when you take like a creme brulee and you take that torch on it and it makes it hard and crusty, that's what it does to the mitochondria in your cells. It literally kills them. Those are the powerhouses in your cells. And as those die, then your body loses the ability to actually burn fat. And so then all of a sudden, it's this vicious downward cycle there. So here's the you've been lied to slide that I alluded to. So one hour after eating a meal, this is like if everything looks good on the insulin for somebody that is doing the somebody that has diabetes, right? This is when, if they're eating their ADA recommendations, this right here, look at this. 2 hours after a meal, this is somebody that's pre-diabetic eating the ADA. They all of a sudden become diabetic. But look at this. Just eating those 40 to 60 grams of carbohydrate per meal that the American Diabetes Association recommends, you become a diabetic just by eating what they recommend. You got to change who you're listening to, because there's too much money, there's too much of a vested interest in this process. This is big business that affects almost 50% of the people in the United States. By the way, if your A1C, if you eat the A1, if you're eating like the American Diabetes Association guidelines, your A1C is going to be over 7, which means that you're pretty much diabetic anyways. Now, so you could actually follow their guidelines and become a diabetic following their guidelines. Yeah. Let's make a different choice. So really, the thing that I really want to talk about is, look, you can reverse it between 1 and 8 weeks. I had a guy that was at 400, and he was unmedicated at 400, and he just, because the medication was making him sick, it was giving him diarrhea. And he didn't know what to do, he was stuck. We just made a radical shift, and in 3 weeks, his blood sugar dropped down to 100, and like literally, this is a 38-year-old male. Like, if you can do it. Now, the length of time that we've had something, obviously, sometimes it takes some time for the blood, the receptors to recharge and regenerate in your body, but your body's designed to heal. If you cut yourself, you can heal. If you can, if you're still alive, those receptors can heal. You just have to stop injuring it. And that's what you have to understand is the foods that we eat, they're either energizing or injuring our bodies here. So this is a study a friend of mine, Dr. Fred Roberto, did. You might have seen him. He's the guy on the T3 videos, always has a hat on backwards. And he always like, you know, by the way, he's an old guy too. Like, and he's the one out jumping the wrestlers and out jumping the judo players there. And basically what they did is they took somebody with type 2 diabetes, and they put him through, he basically couldn't get out of a chair, couldn't walk, couldn't really exercise. And all they did was start adjusting him and change his nutrition there. And with it, and then all of a sudden, next thing you know, boom, all of a sudden his diabetes goes away. This is what he followed the five essential plan there, removed toxins, started exercising, And literally, this is a guy whose A1C is normal levels, his, and this actually happened within just about a month. Okay? That was life-changing for him. So here's the thing. Here's your nutrition suggestions here. By the way, Alyssa's doing a great job. She's been uploading stuff to the website beforehand, so then you don't have to get an email like a month later when we're trying to figure out how to get things out or things get into your trash box there. But basically, you just got to eat whole foods. There's foods by God, as close to the source as possible. The further away from its original form that it is, the more likely that it's going to cause diabetes, the more likely that it's going to be toxic there. High fat, moderate protein, and low carbohydrate. And the reason why I say low protein is the old, do you guys remember Atkins?
Mm-hmm.
So what happens is that Atkins said, basically, eat all the bacon that you want, eat all the meat that you want, eat all the, you know, the salami that you want. It was like the best diet. And I actually even tried it because like it sounded like my wife would not say anything to me if I was on that diet. Like, I'm on a diet. Give me a break. Right? But the problem was is that when you have too much protein, it eventually converts to sugar. That's why when somebody says like, hey, I'm just gonna drink perfect protein, like if they're like they're on the advanced plan and they're drinking a whole bunch of shakes, the perfect protein shakes, they're like, I'm just not losing weight. And I'm like, how many shakes a day are you having? Like four? I'm like, of course. Like it's turning to sugar after a certain amount of time. You can only have moderate amounts of protein then. You have to, if you're diabetic, you have to eliminate fruit. And I'm sorry about that. There's other ways that we can get our antioxidants there. Fruit is great, but what happens is that we think, oh, I need antioxidants. The problem is that when you eat fat as compared to sugar, there's 50 times more free radicals produced with a gram of sugar than there is a gram of fat. 50 times more free radicals. That's why we eat fruit, because there are antioxidants in there. So there's 50 times more nuclear waste released. It's the difference between like a coal plant, right? When you have sugar, it's just like smoke coming out and all this refuse and damaging the environment there. The cool thing is that you'll eliminate cravings. So I guarantee you that anybody that's been on the advanced plan for 2 weeks, they just stop having cravings. They're like, and anybody that's not on the advanced plan, they're like, I just can't do it because I just can't give up my bread. I can't give up my pastas. I love my what? Chocolate, right? You know, that's the biggest thing there. This isn't a diet, by the way. This is just healthy living. It's just common sense living. But like if it was a diet, then there's a beginning and to an end of it. But when you start looking at it as a lifestyle, is it how you live your life, like then it changes the way that you see life there. So how to become a diabetes label reader, and I want to make sure that I cover this, but you know, I'm going to move through this part right here. Minimal ingredients, look for natural ingredients, and this will be, this whole presentation will be up on the website. Do put items back if they contain unnatural and toxic ingredients. So if it doesn't come from the ground or under a tree, just put it back. Because here's the problem is that the toxins create inflammation, okay? Inflammation, if you remember, is right at the top of the maze, the diabetes maze. The more toxic that we are, the more problems that we're gonna have. Don't ever buy anything with MSG or hydrolyzed anything or autolyzed or artificial sweeteners. You know, just because it, you know, sucralose, spends these things right here, those are neurotoxins. Like these are toxic to your nervous system. Your nervous system controls every single tissue, cell, and organ in your body. Like if you're ever trying to function and heal and repair and regenerate, why would you ever take a NutraSweet into your body? The hydrogenated, they literally, anything that's hydrogenated or hydrolyzed, it covers up the fat cell for 51 days. The half-life is 51 days. So when you have a french fry for the next 51 days, your body is suffering the consequences of the fat cell becoming concrete, so you can't get nutrients in and you can't get the toxins out. And the problem is that if you can't go to the bathroom and you can't get new food in, eventually you're gonna die early. That's the same thing that happens with the cells. The cells die early, but the problem is they only have so many times that they can replicate. So if you're killing your cells at an accelerated rate, through inflammation and the foods that we're eating and the toxins that we're exposed to, literally you're prematurely aging yourself. And in fact, there was a study that came out that said that the average person in the United States is biologically 14 years older than they are, right? Than their current age. Biologically, they're 14 years older. The average child that's 2 years old right now is 4 years older biologically than their age. So they literally have, they're like, we're eight, or because of how we're doing things, we're aging at an accelerated rate there. By the way, don't be fooled by slick marketing stuff. So like if it says natural, like I'm like, it's like that person that says, trust me. You know what I mean? Like you wouldn't have to say trust me if you were trustworthy. Does that make sense? Like you know, it's okay. What do you mean it's okay? Like why would you, you know what I mean? Like you don't have to prove yourself to me. Like you have to know how to read labels. And that's why we do shopping trips. That's why we do classes like this to be able to teach you. Now I messed up on the PowerPoint though. Okay, so hidden sugars. This is a big one for us. Like literally, like if you just cut out sodas, like you could actually, they actually call sodas like the new smoking. Like literally, like the average person that drinks soda is, it's 4.6 years of life lost just from drinking soda. The average person that smokes is 4.3 years. So you actually lose more life from drinking sodas than you actually, so might as well take up smoking and give up sodas. Okay? I'm not saying, that's not my doctrine, but I say give up both. But literally, you know, the problem is that that two-thirds comes from hidden sources, and it's the legibles. It's the things that you don't see, salad dressing. Like salad dressings and the ketchups and all the different sauces that are out there. If you're just looking, you're like, oh, I got nothing. I don't eat any sugar. Like, I'm like, oh yeah, let me look at your blood sugar levels because it's hidden in there. Worst thing is fruit juice. Like fruit juice, the problem is we take something that's great with fruit, with antioxidants, and we strip out all the fiber. When we strip out all the fiber, what happens is now fiber binds with sugar. And it literally keeps your blood sugar levels low, but we're like, hey, we got a great idea. Let's take 8 oranges, squeeze them, get all rid of all the fiber, and then just drink it down in one swell, you know, quick gulp, and then maybe have another one or two or three at breakfast and wonder why we feel like garbage and no energy 2 hours later there, and then we have to have like an afternoon snack. So that's why we do the advanced plan. Everybody should have the green book. You should read the green book. I wish I could read it to you, like a bedtime story. Like I've actually thought about literally, like some people don't like to read. And I've actually literally thought about like having a green book. Yes?
Soda, because of all the aspartame, it can also develop like brain tumors.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what we were talking about, like the sucralose and the aspartame. It's just brutal stuff. Yeah, and it's once again, yes?
So what do you tell them when they say, well, there's no proof that aspartame causes cancer? I just talked to somebody, and I'm like, what do you say?
Yeah, so there is, you know, here's the thing. There's people that are called flat worlders. They believe the world's flat. You know what I mean? Like, people are going to believe anything. Like, okay, look, you know, like we know that aspartame's a neurotoxin. So, like, if you take a neurotoxin, obviously, it's probably not, you just say, okay, great, that's fine. Like there's some people you can argue till the cows come home, and they're going to argue their point just because they like to argue.
Yeah.
You mentioned before that you could use stevia, but in a detox situation, would you say not to use that?
I would say no. I mean, like stevia is a great thing because it has that nice sweet when you're trying to make like good meals and stuff like that. But one of the challenges is that when you're like going through a sugar detox process, like what you want to do is just get rid of all of it, because like it's like that person that's like drinking light beer when they're trying to give up alcohol. You know what I mean? Like it's really going to push you back in that direction. So. But what I want to do is, like with the advanced plan, is really it's the sugars and the carbohydrates. We got just to eliminate the grains and the sugars. And we're going to do a challenge. I have a challenge that we're going to do. And this one's pretty cool because we put a lot of time and effort into it. And it's on the website already. But the best part about it is, sometimes like people are like, oh, it's just so complicated. So what we decided to do is, here's the 30-day plan right here. And even better, all you have to do is click on it, and there's a link that takes you to the recipe. So you don't have, you don't even have to think about it. You don't have to look at like what page is that on or anything like that. You just, okay, today's day one. I'm gonna have a stuffed potato patty with green salad and plenty of water. Click, boom. All right, and they'll have the smoothie recipe. Click on the smoothie recipe. It'll take you to the smoothie recipe. So it'll be fun, and so it'll just be autopilot for you. And that's really the goal, is to be able to put a 30-day challenge together for you. And I'm not, you know, like if you want to be part of it. And, be part of it. That's the reason why I didn't print it out this time, because I wanted you to have to take responsibility for what you wanted. All you gotta do is drtgosborne.com, hasn't changed in years, just go into patient resources, and it's right there. All right, so next thing.
A question?
Yes, yes.
So I noticed in the drinks and all that sort of thing, what about beer?
Yeah, so beer is actually the highest thing on the glycemic index. Yes. That's why they have what we call the meatball belly or the beer belly. Yeah, because what happens is that the meatball belly or beer belly is because it raises your blood sugar up so quickly. It's the number one thing. If you Google glycemic index, it's right at the top there.
Liquid bread.
It's liquid bread, yeah. Yes.
How many meals per day do you recommend? It says per like 15 grams of protein for women per meal. How many meals per day?
Oh, like 2-3. So like, and we'll go into that in a second, like as far as the that part there. Yeah.
How about the sugar from juicing vegetables?
Well, so that's a big question. So a lot of times we juice vegetables, but we take all the fiber out of it. So like that's, you know, if you're gonna juice them, like you have a Vitamix, so you can have the fiber in there, because that'll keep the sugar content low there. Because then all of a sudden we raise up the sugar, and take a good thing, and then we kind of destroy it. But we're trying to get healthy, but then now all of a sudden we create this increased sugar, which creates increased inflammation there. So the big thing that I want to really focus on right now is, if we're gonna replace sugar, we got to know what we're gonna replace it with. And so we're gonna have good fats and bad fats there. First thing is that you gotta get rid of bad meat. Like unhealthy meat, cheap meat is literally, I would rather have you not eat meat than eat bad meat. Mm-hmm. There's two types of meat, we always talk about this, but I wanna refresh your mind, review it. There's grass-fed, grain-fed. Grain-fed is that's why they feed it to cows, so the cows get fat. You eat grain, you get fat. Cows eat grain, cows get fat. You eat grain, you get like inflammation, diabetes, toxicity. Cows that they become that. So if you eat grain-fed cows, guess what you're gonna do is you're gonna eat that cow's problem. You're gonna take all the problems that cow had and then just say, and bioaccumulate it in yourself on a daily basis there. Every bit of toxin and pesticide that cow was exposed to, you're just gonna bring it, mainline it right into your body there. So that's why we wanna really have grass-fed. Be careful if you'll see grass finished and grass fed. Grass finished is, they're like, hey, the last couple days we put it on grass and it just it was kind of like a last meal, you know, before they had the green mile or something like that. You know, but the point is that we want to make sure everything is antibiotic free, hormone free, because if the number one usage of antibiotics in the United States is obviously the animal industry there. Antibiotics don't make us healthy, they just keep us from being less sick. But the problem is, when we have antibiotics, now we have to spend the next 4 to 6 months rebuilding our body there. Beef is great, like bison is great because they like to eat grass. Lamb is great because they pretty much are picky and they like to only eat grass there. You want to have free-range chickens, free-range eggs. I really find that it's sometimes it's hard to find it, so that's why it's a big thing for me to have a good whey protein. But this is the big thing for me, is adding good fats in your oil. So I like use coconut oil all the time. I use MCT oil, which is a consolidated form of coconut oil. You don't have too much of it because it'll give you the runs. You put like a nice teaspoon there, it gives you nice energy. Avocados, you walk through our house, you think like we have an avocado tree, which we don't. But we go through avocados like crazy. Nuts and walnuts and almonds are absolutely fantastic. And omega-3 fatty acids, like from wild-caught fish. Don't buy store farm-raised fish. It's the worst thing that you can do for your body. You know, basically what they do is they use salmon. They use what's called the Salmo fan, and it's a color chart that you can add to the food of the salmon that's being farm-fed. And so what it does is you can choose really pink or not really pink. They're white. The salmon are white if they're farm-raised until they add the coloring to them there. And so basically they have the lower omega-3s because they're fed grains. So the thing is that the salmon in the wild, they eat a lot of algae. So if you have an allergy to fish or something like that, you can look at an algae-type supplement, an algae-based supplement, because that's what the fish eat there. That's a great option there. And it's getting harder to find healthy fish. So here's a typical day for you. There's another handout on there about intermittent fasting, and I encourage you to read it. Intermittent fasting is basically expanding the hours of time between your last meal and your first meal. So typically I'll go 12 to 16 hours. Obviously you guys notice I don't have a lack of energy. My last meal of the day, and then I usually will have my first meal of the day sometime at lunchtime. And the reason being is I want to lower my blood sugar level so that I can always stay in my fat burning mode. But that's too much for this class, but I just want to make you aware it's on the website there. But a lot of times, you know, I will, if I have a workout or something like that, I will have a smoothie. I usually start my day with something simple on my digestive system, a smoothie or like a juice or something like that, but something with a higher protein eggs. Lunch usually is a much simpler meal there for me. It's like kind of easing my way in there, but I have my bigger meals at dinner. I'll have my proteins, I'll have a lot of vegetables at that time, at least 2 to 3 servings of vegetables there at that time. And that's on the plan there. I've outlined everything for you guys. I just wanted to just touch one thing because somebody asked me to put this in. Artificial sweeteners, what they do is they trick your brain. Your brain thinks that it's tasting something sweet, and so it's looking for the sweetness, and it's raising up the insulin levels in preparation. Because do you guys remember Pavlov's dogs?
Mm-hmm.
You ever heard that? So what they found was that Pavlov's dogs, he would ring a bell, and they would start to salivate there. And then what he noticed was is that he didn't even have to ring the bell. All he'd have to do is walk towards the bell, and the dogs would start to salivate there. And then what he noticed was that because he rang the bell at the same time, the dogs would start to salivate at the same time every day without even seeing him. So when your brain and your taste buds think that something sweet, it'll raise your actual blood sugar levels up. I mean, your insulin levels up, and all of a sudden you're going to get hungrier. So as people that are Diet Coke addicts, that's probably why you haven't lost the weight, is because you're always looking for something because your insulin's up. The other thing is that it obviously there's toxins in it, it's all the aspartames and everything. So this is another one, eliminating alcohol and tobacco, which, look, if you have diabetes, you have no business drinking. You know, you've already done your parting with cake and ice cream, okay? Like, there's always a place for, like, you know, if you wanted to have a glass of wine or something, but I need you to understand this is a mission critical point in your life. That you literally have, you've already, like, it's what they call the marshmallow test. Like, I think it was in the 60s, they did this test where they took kids and they gave them a marshmallow. And they said, if you can not eat this marshmallow for 15 minutes, we'll give you 2 marshmallows. Well, most of the kids ate the marshmallow. But what they found was that 30 years later, the kids that were actually, that didn't eat the marshmallow, they were worth more than all the rest of those kids combined because they were able to delay their gratification. And so what I need you to understand is that to make these changes, we have to delay our gratification. We have to put off what we want today for what we want tomorrow, because here's the thing. I mean, seriously, like after you eat the cookie, right?
Yeah.
Are you ever like, oh, I should have eaten that cookie. That was a really good idea. You know what I mean? Like nobody ever eats a cookie and like 2 hours later when they're trying to get in their pants the next morning are like, I'm really glad that I ate that cookie. You know what I mean? Like you forgot about it. And so just know that delay your gratification so that you can have like, you know, 2 tomorrow. You can have more tomorrow than you want today because you want to stop eating for how it tastes as opposed to how it feels, how we want to feel there. Alcohol is crazy because it'll literally destroy our blood sugar. Like literally it destroys your liver. It raises up your blood sugar, literally it spikes it up. That's why people become alcoholics. It's not that the alcohol, but what ends up happening is it raises up your blood sugar so quickly, insulin goes up really quickly, and then all of a sudden it crashes down. By the time you're finished with that, it's time for a second what?
Right.
And then all of a sudden your blood sugar goes up, dopamine levels go up, blood sugar comes down, you're like, oh my gosh, it feels so bad. I need to have a second drink, a third drink. And that's why the bottles of wine always seem to get empty at the end of the night when you're just going to have one glass. That was a mistake. I was going to put a thing of vitamin D on there. But I just want to tell you, like, a couple of things in the challenge that are really important. And this is an essential. You can make vitamin D, but unless you're running around naked during the day and you're out in the sun during the day, you're going to be vitamin D deficient. But basically, what I need you to understand is that somebody with diabetes, they're typically, their average person with diabetes, their vitamin D levels are less than 50. Normal is going to be about 24, I think. Normal, like as long as you go to your doctor, he's like, oh, you have normal blood vitamin D levels. And if it's at 24 and above, that's considered healthy. Anything below 50, tip, the average person with diabetes is below 50. The average person without cancer is above 65. The average person with cancer is below 65. But to get up to those levels, it'll take at least 6 months, depending on how deficient you are, how much You expose yourself to the sunlight, you know, what your lifestyle looks like. But it literally, it reduces your risk of diabetes by 55%. Literally, if you had a doctor that said, hey, I have medication that will reduce your risk of ever getting diabetes by 55%, would you buy it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, of course you would. And
what
it's something.
Should you take about that?
What's that?
Which vitamin you should take?
Great question. So the average, the recommendations for vitamin D are typically for every 35 pounds, about 1,000 units that somebody is. And I've seen other studies that say for every 50 pounds, a person is, you could take 1,000 units there. RDA, I think, is like, you know, 400 units.
What's NMOL?
Nanomoles per deciliter. So I should have just left that off.
Yeah.
But, you know, this is what the Vitamin D Council recommends for optimal health, is about 125. That's high. If you're at 100, I'm going to be stoked. Like, and in fact, you will be stoked because you'll be way healthier there. The other thing is, Mac, like greens. So you had a question about, like, you know, like, how do we get our juices? I'm a big greens fan there. We don't have, and I'm going to tell you something that's kind of crazy. We don't have our Max Greens that we're carrying here just because they did something with, like, the laws where, like, you can't, you have to have, like, a, you know, the Prop 51 labels or what is it, that thing that you see at the gas stations and stuff like that. So that, like, we have, like, the most minuscule amount of, like something in there that, like, it's fine in every other state besides the state of California, but it's an organic thing, and they're like, no. So one of the things that the greens that I'm really looking at right now is something called Green Vibrance. You can find it at Whole Foods. I absolutely love it. It tastes like grass, but you just, you know, but it gives you tons of energy, and it's incredibly alkalizing there. But I love the greens because what they do is they, what's that? Green Vibrance, yeah.
Can we add something to it to make the
taste? Oh yeah. Yeah, you can add, like, you know, Perfect Protein to it. You can add, like, you know, like, there's a ton of stuff that you can do. So, like, anyways, I just pound it. A lot of times you'll see my jar up here. A lot of different colors in there depending on what I'm trying to get in there. But it protects against insulin producing, like the cells there, so it'll lower the blood sugar there. It has the fiber in there, it has all the phytonutrients in there. So if you don't have time to be able to, like, go out and, you know, like, you're on the road all the time, this is a great thing for you to be able to incorporate in there. But because it's alkalizing, because it becomes very anti-inflammatory, which reduces the inflammation of the cells. And so I want you to think in the grand scheme of things, we're not trying to fix your body, we're trying to fix your cell. You're only as healthy as your cells are. So if we fix the cell, we fix the body. And so, like, when you start thinking about what you need to become healthy, you have to start thinking about what your cell needs to become healthy. And I don't have time to go into this tonight, and maybe I'll put an article up on, Alyssa, on gastrointestinal function and diabetes, because it's literally an entire class there. But when your gut is off, it creates chronic inflammation throughout the rest of your entire body. And it creates, and that is a major factor there. So if your gut is off and the bacteria is off in there, there's major issues that are happening. Like, in fact, there's two really big things that, like, if we're looking at system, the brain and the gut. And they both are connected. The gut-brain axis is literally the pivotal thing for somebody's entire health there. This is the perfect protein that we have. Basically, it's grass-fed, it's whey protein, it's no sugar in it. Like, literally, the only sugar that's in there is, like, milk sugar in there. If you're allergic to milk, then we have, like, a plant-based protein there. But I think this is a great way to just be able to support that, you know, that daily lifestyle if you want to have something in the morning. Yeah.
I went out and bought some whey protein and some other, you know, in the big jars. And then I came across something that said something about, what's the other protein?
Soy protein isolate?
Soybean?
Uh-huh.
Or whatever. And something negative. I can't remember much of what it said.
Yeah,
so I gave up on both of them.
I'll stick with whey. Because soy basically affects hormones there. And so, like, I'm not a big soy fan.
So the whey is good.
Yeah.
So
I wouldn't even talk about it if I didn't, like, support
soy
it.
Soy sometimes with pot can cause cancer.
Yeah.
Large
doses. The soy? Yeah.
What about beans? Like, are Bonzo's beans or kidney beans or protein?
Yeah, you can definitely use those. Just make sure you soak them. Don't get them out of the can. This is the big one, though. This is the vitamin D and omega-3s are my loves. Like, I love those. Like, I don't go a day without having them. Like, literally, they're my everybody every day. In fact, I just added probiotics to everybody every day. It's like, those are the three things: probiotics, vitamin D, omega-3, everybody every day. They're literally essentials because it's really hard to get a good balance in our diet there. But look at this, it stabilizes blood sugar, increases tolerance, protects against the development of diabetes, lowers blood pressure, cholesterol, prevents cancer, improves brain function, and fights depression. Find me a pill that any doctor has that does that. Yes?
So omega-3s have fish oil in them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so then you can, there's the different
can
things.
Can you get the vegan, and that will still do the same thing?
I'll talk to you about that. I just want to make sure we, and this is the last one that I want to talk about. For people that are in acute scenarios right now, MaxFit's really awesome because it helps to, it has adaptogenic herbs in there. We're going to talk about this in a second, but the stress will raise, one of the first things that stress does is it raises our blood sugar. So sometimes we can't get rid of the stresses, but we being able to have the adaptogenic herbs that help us adapt to the stress there, the things that will actually help support our metabolism there. MaxFit's a great starter for somebody that's in a chronic state. So basically, I just want to, like, the one thing that a lot of people, most people will do anything, they'll literally buy anything to get healthy. Does that make sense? They'll buy any pill, any potion, any lotion, they'll buy, like, anything that they possibly can. And then when I say, let's exercise, they're like, oh, it's just so hard, right? So, yeah, excuse me for spitting on you. But here's the thing, what I need you to understand, exercise is a genetic requirement for you. It's a genetic requirement. Like, if you're not exercising, like, there's no way that you, if you have diabetes, there's no way you're ever going to be able to fix the cause. You're never going to be able to get to that because exercise burns the blood sugar. It metabolism, it resets leptin, it balances out insulin there. It literally changes everything there. But the most important thing is this. Look, it's you have to move for proper brain function. Your brain controls your entire body. So if you're not moving, like that's why, like, have you ever been sitting in front of the TV for a couple hours and like you just feel like you have no energy? Mm-hmm. It's not like you don't have energy, right? Like you should have, but you've been conserving it for hours there. It's just that your brain is a battery and it's running at 1%. You've turned off, you know, like airplane mode and you're like, your screen, like brightness is all the way down. That's like the phone's still working, but it's not really working there. But exercise boosts it. Like when they look at like people, like mice, or like with the memory, but they, when they look at people's brains, they find that they have, people that exercise on a regular basis actually have 2.5 times more new nerve cells there. And in fact, check this out. This just came out the other day. They actually followed groups of people, and they found that the type of exercise that you do is incredibly important. They actually looked at people that went on the treadmill for 40 minutes a day, and they followed them for 6 months. Guess what the average weight loss was? 2.2 kilograms. So they literally had to exercise something like 700 hours to lose 5 pounds? Yeah, so would you be willing, if I would say, hey, look, I want you to get on a treadmill for 700 hours to lose 5 pounds, do you think that you'd really want to do that?
No,
that'd be the most ridiculous thing in the world, right? But when they actually had people do something called high-intensity exercise, and they compared the two groups, what you have an aerobic group, and you have a high-intensity group, what they found was the people that do high-intensity exercise, they actually, not only did they lose more weight, they actually doubled the weight loss, which is like 10 pounds, but they actually found that their muscle mass was significantly higher, their fat mass was much lower, their blood sugar levels actually, their whole metabolic function changed, and even the mitochondria and the powerhouses of their cells were functioning better. And they were only exercising 4 to 6 minutes as opposed to 40 minutes. How crazy is that? So you mean that you don't have to be on the treadmill for 700 hours at 40 minutes a day? I guess that kind of gets rid of the excuse I don't have any time, right? Mm-hmm. And most of the certs that we teach, you could just do squats for 4 to 6 minutes as fast as you possibly can, and next thing you know, you're fighting diabetes. There is no excuse. And in fact, when they look at these people, yeah, 4 to 6 minutes, yeah. Just by doing high intensity exercise, it beat metformin. It beat metformin 3-1. Like just knocked him out. Like if it's like, you know, like it beat metformin just by doing high intensity exercise there. How cool is that? Can you imagine if the drug companies could figure out how to put exercise into a pill? That'd be the most expensive pill ever, right? But like you actually have to do something. And so that's why we have exercise classes Monday, Wednesdays, and Saturdays here. Not because we have nothing else to do, but because we believe it's that important there. The metabolic effect, this is like one of our surge training classes. I think Maurice was actually tired at that point there. But what they look at there is it increases the metabolic effect. It increases insulin sensitivity. It increases your ability when you do high intensity to actually get oxygen. And guess what? What's really cool is that when you're doing high intensity exercise, you know they tell you to exercise and to run like this and you should be able to talk. Well, the cool thing about that is that when you're running and you're talking, well, then you're burning fat at that time. That's great. And so you go run for an hour, and then you're burning fat for that hour. And then guess what? For the next 36 hours to 48 hours, you're burning sugar. And so that's when you're like, I gotta. And what they find is that people that do aerobic exercise, they actually have increased cravings. That's one of the reasons why they gain weight, is because their body is looking for actual sugar. And because of that aerobic exercise over a long period of time, it raises those insulin levels because it becomes a stress. And so all of a sudden they raise their insulin levels, it becomes a stress, they start to like crave more sugars, and they actually eat more than they're actually burning off. Cool thing about the high intensity exercise is this. When you're exercising high intensity, you're burning sugar. So talking with your friend, you're burning fat for 40 minutes. 12 minutes of high intensity exercise, you're burning sugar, but you're burning fat for the next 24 to 36 hours. So when you're sitting on the couch afterwards, you're burning fat. When you're driving to work for the next day, you're burning fat. When you're sitting at your computer, you're burning fat. When you're sleeping, you're burning fat. When you walk past that pie and don't eat it, you're burning fat. So that's really what we want to make sure that's the difference. When people, they get confused, they're like, I'm working out, I'm going for a walk. Yeah, going for a walk is good for your brain, but it doesn't do anything to change your metabolism and to burn the fat there. This is the crew after one of our surges right there. Short burst of high intensity exercise improves cholesterol. Anybody want to lower cholesterol? Improves blood sugar. Anybody want to take care of blood sugar? Weight. Type 2 diabetes compared to 30 minutes of sustained. So literally, you just cut down the amount of time and you increase your effort. That's where all the bonuses are in life there. By the way, the twofold greater improvement in their A1C as opposed to people on a treadmill. So if A1C is an indicator of like the level of somebody's if their diabetes is getting better or worse, they get a twofold improvement, twice the amount of improvement in lowering their diabetes levels there. So that's why you all got when you first came in. Do you ever wonder why we gave you that five essential kit when you first started? Like there's three books in there. There's the green book, because we wanted you to read the green book because we thought it would change your life, right? And then we gave you the T3 video in there because we wanted you to do it because we knew that it would change your life. We gave you the cruise ship or nursing home book so you could see all five essentials and mainly be able to make a decision whether you're going to live on the cruise ship or in the nursing home and let you know that was the point. So T3 is basically 12 minutes of exercise. All you have to do is take this, if you have it, take it, flip it around. On the back, there's a website, and you can actually, and then you take the serial number to the website, and then you can actually have online access. So like, you're out in the middle of a field, and you're like, I don't know what to do. And I'm like, hey, I'm gonna do my T3 exercises right now. Hey, I'm at my grandma's house, and it's freezing cold. I'm just gonna do my T3. Like literally, we've taken all the excuses. Used to be like, well, I just don't have a DVD player. I'm like, really? Figure it out. But so this is a huge thing. Just come to the classes, do your T3. You don't have to be as good as everybody else. You just have to be the very best you there. But I just really want to kind of get down to the last part here. I always say the nervous system for last because it's what I absolutely love. But what I want you to see is that stress is literally the number one killer. Because what happens is when we're under stress, what it does is it raises our insulin levels. Okay? Stress raises our insulin levels, it raises our cortisol levels. But when we have our insulin levels up, because we need to be able to, it's expecting a big rush of blood sugar coming into our body, like it needs to get blood sugar from the muscles there to be able to run from that tiger. Well, all of a sudden, now we have these high insulin levels. And most of us, what do our lives look like? Are they kind of like low stress, sitting on a desert isle, you know, hanging out, right? Like just living just from getting from here at Christmas time to the mall is ridiculous. It takes like 2 hours to be able to do that. But what happens is that Stress, like when we have stress, we have two types of stress, sympathetic stress. What it'll do is it'll increase the cortisol levels. It'll increase the blood sugars in our bodies there, and it'll increase the oxidative stress or the inflammation in our body. That's the biggest thing that I want you to understand, is that that's why Max Mind is number one. Because if you don't change your mindset, if you don't change how you perceive the world, if you don't change how you respond to the world, if you don't change your outside environment, then you can eat. But the problem is, you can eat right, but the problem is that you think differently when you're under stress. You don't think 5 years in the future, right? That's why they have stress eating. Like, they don't have like relaxed eating, they have stress eating. Stress eating is like, you know, you just grab the closest thing to you. Like, because it's creating that short-term goals there. But the problem is that, this is why as a chiropractor, when we start looking at somebody, how you perceive the world through your nervous system. When somebody's subluxated, it puts stress up into the brain, and the body's not able to adapt to the stresses as well. And the problem is, when somebody's subluxated, we see an imbalance in the nervous system. And then you start looking at this, like all these types of things are research things that show that when people's nervous system's out of balance, and they were testing them through something called heart rate variability, which when somebody gets adjusted, that's one of the number one things that happens, is their adaptability of their nervous system is actually the first thing that happens there. So, like, think about this. Now you're subluxated, and that's the term that we use for an interference with the nervous system, and you have all these issues, and then what would most people do? They start to go look for what? Okay, what's the pill that I can take to fix my cold hands there, right? And so, like, they try that one, they're like, oh, that doesn't work. Maybe I can go on to this particular diet, or I can do that. But, you know, think about this. It's like, if you're trying to eat right, and one of the problems that we're starting to have is that you can't, like, actually, like, digest food because you have an irritable bowel there, and, like, you can't digest your food and absorb your food, because when we're under stress, it shuts down the digestive process there. Well, then, of course, you're just wasting your food, right? You have to be able to have your body be able to digest food. And that's why when we start looking at the nervous system, it's huge. They call them the two super system. The two super systems in your body are your immune system and your nervous system. And the thing that balances the immune system is the immune system is your nervous system. And the nervous system is responsible for regulating all those 40 hormones in your body, adapting how your body adapts to stress on a daily basis. That's why we adjust people. I don't adjust somebody whether they have back pain or not. Like, literally, if that was my life, was like just to take care of back pain, I would probably not practice. I really wouldn't. That would be the most horrible thing that I could possibly do. Because, like, all people would want to do is complain about their back pain and the pains and this. But I know that every single time I adjust somebody, every single time I make a correction, every single time we get that curve in their neck back, every single time we make changes, we're making dramatic impacts on how their brain functions and how their body adapts to their environment. So can you imagine, like, leaving your kids at home to be subluxated? It makes no sense to me. Like, why would you ever, why would you ever be here and know this information and then leave somebody that you love at home to be subluxated? It makes no sense. And so this was an interesting study that just came out. When we look at, and I'm not going to go through all of these, but look at this. They actually, this is pre-adjustment and post-adjustment right here. And they look at salivary amylase. Like, after somebody gets adjusted, that's an indicator of stress. Significantly goes down. Muscle tone significantly goes down. All their stresses on there subjectively significantly gets better. We look at how the brain was metabolizing sugar. When somebody gets adjusted, that actually gets increased glucose metabolism in their brain. Like, when we start looking at how the brain's function, that everything changes in the entire body. Every single process that we look at for how your body adapts to stress changes when somebody gets adjusted there. That's massive. And that happens every single time. Have you ever gotten off the table and you're like, I feel better? That's what happens, because it's your brain change. Your whole body changes once your brain changes there. This is what happens when I want you to see, this is an EEG. So this is a normal, what they call a flat line. This is like somebody that has an imbalanced pattern there. This is somebody after they got adjusted, their brain started going into balance. This is another one. This is after their brain goes into balance. By the way, this one right here, do you see how these two look the same? Mm-hmm. This is somebody that got adjusted, but they didn't have major spinal issues. So their brain was healthy, and they didn't have to change their brain. Does that make sense? So if you're subluxated, it's going to help. And if you're doing fine, It's not going to change because your nervous system's already working right there. And so this is where it comes down to the last. Henry Peterson asked these people, how much weight can you hold? And he said, it's not the amount of weight that you have, it's how long you have to hold it. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem. Because we get used to holding this weight, and we hold it for not a day, a week, a month, or a year, but the stresses that we have accumulated over our lifetime started from the day that we were born. We talk about the average child now, when they're born, has over 286 chemical contaminants in their fetal cord blood. Mm-hmm. And then over a lifetime, we're exposed to thousands and thousands of things, and emotional stresses and physical stresses and chemical stresses, they compound, and they seem small things over time, but that weight slowly breaks us down. And so what we have to do is we have to get rid of those stresses, but we have to increase our adaptability to stress. That's what the nervous system is about. So look, if you've got a patient, get your spine checked. Whether in my office or any other office, I don't care. I mean, our office, obviously, you guys know, is busy, but it's the point is that I know that we deliver the best service here. I know that we care more than anybody else. I know, the only way is our job with the five essentials is, look, you're going to create subluxations. The five essentials are teaching you how not to recreate your subluxations and reduce it to the most minimal level so that your nervous system can function the best it possibly can. So this is the last thing. Diabetes slayers for the next 30 days. I want you guys to determine your big why. I don't know if you saw my big why video. I put it online. Mm-hmm. And it was a kind of a cool background. Did you see it?
Yeah.
But what was neat, and it's on the Facebook, but I just basically sat down. I found this room where somebody was filming it, and a friend of mine took his iPhone, and we just recorded it. And it was just off the cuff. And he's like, why do you do what you do? Why do you get so fired up? And that's why I recorded that. But the thing is that you got to find your big why of why you're going to do this. Because I was talking to somebody about this, a really great friend of ours, and she's like, I just am having a hard time and struggling. And I'm like, that's because your why is not big enough. Does that make sense? Your why is not big enough to overcome the donut. I've had people that they were having challenges, they get cancer, and then they find the biggest why that they possibly can. I find somebody that they have somebody die in their family, and all of a sudden they find the why there. Usually the problem is that we make the why about something that's really insignificant, about how you look. You know what I mean? I want to be a size 10. You would have already been a size 10 if that was important to you. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. You would have already been in that bikini if being in a bikini was important to you. Usually we have to look at the why to make it bigger so that it can actually have a bigger impact there. Change the software that you're running on. And you got to start looking at your belief systems, who you are. Do you think you're worthy? And do you think you deserve to be healthy there? Because a lot of times we have issues that say, I'm not worthy, and I don't deserve to be healthy. I'm not good enough. I'm not strong enough. And you have to change those programs there. Make over your meals and simplify. That's what my job was on this, was to give you a makeover to your meals to be able to simplify it. And it's on there, and it literally is your roadmap to success on there. And I even put right here a checklist for you. And there's literally a checklist on here, so you can give yourself attaboys as you go through the process. Because a lot of times you get in the process, you're like, oh my gosh, I kind of blew it today. Well, if you blew it today on something, then you can write it down, you're like, oh, well, I'll just get better at that tomorrow. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And then you'll be able to see that maybe you really sucked at the beginning, and then you mastered it at the end. Mm-hmm. And then you get to celebrate there. Make exercise a priority, get it in your schedule. Look, 12 minutes, there is no excuse. You don't even have to have shoes. You can exercise in your underwear when nobody's watching, okay? Avoid toxic exposures. You're going to really have to look into this one. And so looking into the toxic exposures, it's in the foods, yes?
My feet, well, one of them is half a foot, and it's structurally, I'm glad I'm walking.
Yeah.
The other one, the bones melted, and they had to come back, and it's just,
sure. Here, we'll have a modified surgery for it.
I'm thinking a bicycle.
Yeah, there's anything. Talk to me about it.
High intensity or whatever.
Yeah, no problems.
So I don't have
I had a lady, Alicia, that was in a wheelchair. She was in a power wheelchair, I don't know if you remember, but and she literally, yeah. There you go, there's more. Sister, sorry.
Yeah.
But she literally would drive her in a powered wheelchair, and she would sit here with two soup cans, right? And she would just do two soup cans, working out there, and then she'd have a band there. And then eventually, her workout was getting in and out of the wheelchair, and eventually she was, walking. I mean, don't let your experience be your excuse, right? Don't let your experience limit your expectations there. And so we'll help you with that. I'll help you figure that out. And take care of your nervous system. If you're a patient, keep taking care of it. Do your home care. Like, minimize, like, watch how you sit, sleep, and stand. Look at, like, the things that are recreating the subluxation. Stay away from the couch potato chair, otherwise you end up looking like a potato, right? And so, like, but at the same time, do your wobbles, do your tractions, do all the things that we tell you. We don't tell you to do something just because we're like, hey, we got nothing else to talk about. Let's talk about home care exercises, right? Like, we want the very best for you there. The other thing is that, like, if you've never had your spine checked, get a check. Just talk to one of the girls at the front desk. It's just $40 to be able to get your entire spine checked, and if there's pictures or anything like that. And the last thing is that share this information with everybody else. I think we Facebook Live it. Hopefully it went out there, and hopefully it worked. If it did, fantastic. If not, it did. It worked. Good. So when you get on Facebook, just share it to get it out there, because I really think I want to make sure we create a groundswell. If there's enough interest, we'll do like another one. And another one, and another one. Like if there's somebody that you need to that needs to hear this, let me know. I think that the last thing, and I told you this was the last, but I think the thing is this. This is San Jose. This is our town, right? And we lose perspective on how big it was. But like, what if we were to understand the times that we're in? Like, what if we were to truly understand the times that we're in, where we have over 50% of the people in the United States have been diagnosed with depression, and almost 50% have diabetes, and you know, like, the number one cause of death according to the Journal of American Medical Association right now is actually our healthcare system that we live in. Like, what if we were to understand the times that we actually live in here, where neighbors don't, where people don't have empathy, and they don't have an ability to emotionally bond, and we know that when somebody takes something as simple as an ibuprofen more than 8 times in a row, they find that it actually reduces your ability to actually empathize with human beings and actually feel emotions. So you have 33 million people taking ibuprofen on a regular basis walking around the United States that are literally what they call, like, you know, like ibuprofen zombies there. Think about 10% of those people. It takes 10% of the population to change the way that the rest of the population thinks. So no wonder why just something as simple as that can happen. Think about the times that we're in. What if we were to really understand that we are more powerful than we know, and that there is an intelligence, that there's a power that made our body, there's a power that heals our body, and that everything, our body, our lives were made to be good. And it's through our choices, our free will, that they end up where they are. And then we also know that we also have free will to make a different choice. And I think if we can make those choices, not only for us, but then when we fully understand the world that we live in, then we can have a completely different world. But until we get into reality, we can't make changes. And that's what tonight was about. And so I just thank you guys for being here tonight. I just ask one thing, is that that you take action. Like, this was, the information's good, but literally, you could have not been here tonight, and if you didn't take any action on the information, just take one small thing, or radically change everything, or just do something. Like, I had one of the moms that was in today, she was trying to, like, put sugar into the hummingbird feeder, and was asking the kids where the sugar was, and he goes, "Mom, that's, like, outlawed." You know what I mean? Her kids are like, they don't even have sugar in the house. They couldn't even feed the hummingbirds. Like, that's what I want it to be. It's not that we want to be, we need to get a little bit crazy, because it's the crazy ones that change the world. And I appreciate you guys for being here. And I just thank you for your patience, because I obviously went a little bit longer than I thought. All right. Okay. Questions, I'll stay around and answer them about anything specifically. Okay? And if, as far as anybody that wants to get checked and hasn't had family members checked or hasn't had their spine checked, just like the girls in the front.
Sure.
Thank you.